Professor, your family left Hungary in 1956 and you then went to Canada and then you went to universities in the UK. From your experience, are there any parallels from what we're seeing in the West now to what we saw before the fall of the Berlin Wall in Eastern Europe and the spirit of censorship that prevailed in Eastern Europe for such a long period of time?
Well, as funny as it would sound, the censorship in the old Stalinist world was much easier to deal with than the censorship we're faced with today. And the reason for that is because everybody knew what the score was. I remember growing up as an eight-year-old, my dad telling me, don't believe that, Frank. And whatever we heard, we just never believed. And we just, you know, we had our own narrative about what the world was like. And it was really easy to see through all the lies. I think most of us in my community had no doubt about what was right and what was wrong. We could deal with that. The problem that we have today is that our censorship is driven in the first instance by very powerful cultural forces, which basically mean that a lot of the censorship, the most insidious form of censorship, is first of all self-censorship. It's when people who know better look the other way, and when people that know better, you know, sort of censor themselves from saying what is really going on, because that is really, you know, a kind of denial of yourself. You see that something is happening. For example, in England, everybody could see that all these children were being misused in Rotherham. I mean, that was an open secret. Everybody knew what was going on. But nobody in the political class actually had the courage to say, you know, these men were actually destroying a whole generation of young kids in a place like Rotherham. So that's self-censorship. And that's very difficult to fight because it's you, an important parcel of you. And secondly, I think one of the problems that we have is that the aspiration for free speech is often very rhetorical, and there aren't enough people around who really want to fight for it. And because of that, it means that the younger generations, who are the future, and they're going to decide whether we're going to be free or not, are continually being influenced by cultural forces that are anti-liberty, because liberty has become a dirty word in many parts of the world. And then they are continually influenced by academics, teachers, politicians, so-called role models, who are continually in the business of censoring themselves. And I think that kind of censorship means that the politics is much more difficult to actually confront, because it's underpinned by these forces, which we have to tackle.
Nick, you grew up in England in the 60s and 70s. That would have been like Hungary in the 1950s, wouldn't it? Yeah. What was it like?
The food was a bit better, I think, only a little bit. I don't remember. Well, look, I do remember. I mean, those of us who've got vague memories of the 60s. Of course, what was happening in the 60s was that the left, as it then was the great champion of freedom. We had, the Oz trial, you know, where the publishers of Oz were taken to this famous case in London, which became a great anti-censorship trial, and this was in Australia, the Alvin Purple TV series, you know, became a great sort of cause for the left to celebrate sort of freedom of expression and freedom to take your clothes off and so forth on television, and those were the causes they fought, and yet now, if not those people, then their successors in terms of the progressive elite have turned full circle. So I wonder if it's just the case that once you assume authority, as they have now, then you want to shut down debate.
And can I ask both of you then, why has this occurred? Because, Nick, you would have seen this. You would have been called right-wing for believing in freedom of speech. We've both been called extreme libertarians for believing in liberty. How did this happen where once upon a time the right was for conservatism and the left was for freedom, and now it seems to have been completely inverted? Professor.
Well, I don't think it's completely inverted, because the right isn't always as good on freedom as it should be. I think there is honorable exceptions to that, but I think far too many people who say they're for freedom of speech are very selective about the freedoms they are. And I think if we're going to be for freedom of speech, we have to be totally consistent on it. Otherwise, we cannot occupy the moral high ground, and we have to occupy the moral high ground against those who are against free speech. I think the reason why the left has become so censorious, I hate calling them the left, because of my own left-wing background, but I think that the reason why they've become so censorious is number one, they've lost faith in humanity. They really don't think that human beings are capable of great stuff, and therefore they need to be pampered, they need to be protected from themselves, they need to have their hands held. And therefore, if you don't think very much of people, then you don't want to give them too many freedoms, because you think they're going to misuse it. So they really have that kind of very paternalistic impulse behind it. And secondly, I think the left has become totally captured and morally and mentally enslaved by the state. I mean, they really think that you cannot cross the streets, you know, without there being a rule. You cannot have somebody from the state approving you. So they've become so enamored with the state that for these, that they no longer can see freedom as having this kind of incredibly positive impulse. You know, when you and I think of freedom, you know, it's like that kind of Brahms Alto Rhapsody. I don't know if you ever listened to it. Alto Rhapsody has this music of an eagle soaring. That's how I always think of freedom, this eagle soaring, you know, without limits. And I think for them, they would feel uncomfortable with that image. You know, that's the last thing they want to see, is you and I soaring.
Interesting what you say. I mean, it's certainly not restricted to the left, if you like that, if you want to put it like that. And Hayek has written that one of my favourite Hayek essays is Why I'm Not a Conservative. But he points out in there, he sees it rather than being a left-right thing, almost a three-cornered thing between liberals, conservatives, and socialists. And he says that conservatives are equally prone to this form of censorship. They're equally relaxed with the idea of having government, the judiciary and other bodies decide what we can and cannot say, so long as the right chaps are in charge, you know, so long as their people are in charge. Whereas a liberal position is...
As long as Tim is the Human Rights Commissioner.
Well, that's right. That's right. Although if Tim starts trying to tell me what to say, I might have some words to him. But no, that's right. I mean, that's the conservative position according to Hayek. But the liberal position is it doesn't, it's not, it, liberals don't care who's in government. They care about what sort of government it is. And you know, this is an interesting one on 18C, and I wrote about this. You know, 18C came to our notice particularly, of course, with the Andrew Bolt case. But let's not forget it had been on the statute book for what, 15, 16 years before that. And one of the things it was used against was against the Holocaust deniers. And interestingly, many of the people who are now screaming about 18C didn't seem to bother too much about that. I mean, notably some did. Janet Albrechtsen, I remember, wrote a column about how unfair this was. But if freedom of speech, of course, means anything, it means freedom to say anything, even if it's something we vehemently and utterly disagree with. And I know this is a particularly controversial subject, and I respect others who have different views on this, but for me, we have to grant this same freedom to people who would deny the Holocaust, I'm afraid.
Just while the audience is thinking questions, Frank, if I can ask you a question without notice. Your personal journey is an interesting one, from Hungary, Canada, Britain. Your political personal journey is interesting. Could you just speak for a few moments about that?
Well, it's always difficult, because whenever you think of your own past, you're always tempted to rewrite it, you know, and kind of flatter yourself. But I think, to be really honest, I grew up in a very political family in Hungary in the middle of the high Stalinist period, and my dad was imprisoned by the communist government at the time. When he came out, he just was totally, you know, sort of committed to getting rid of it. And both my dad and my sister were involved in the Hungarian Revolution of 56. And the one thing that I learned from him, He was a member of a smallholders party, which is like a small, would it be like a kind of a populist conservative party in Australia. And the one thing I learned from him is never to trust the state. I mean, he was, you know, particularly the communist Stalinist state, but he was against all, and that was the main thing I learned from him as important. The second thing that he said is that if you're a Furedi, you're not on this earth to pass time, but you got to do some good. You got to make sure that when you drop, you left a contribution. Now, I grew up then in the 60s in Canada, and like everybody my age in the 1960s, you know, sort of got caught up in it. I don't regret anything I did. I had a very nice time, you know, a thoroughly nice time. I recognize a lot of stupid, foolish things were done, but I then became involved in, what's called kind of radical communist politics. But even when I was on the far left of the left, I could say one thing that's been a continuity is I always was against the state intervening in our lives. I'd always had a very strong liberal impulse. And in fact, one of the reasons why I kind of shifted my politics is because I noticed, I hope you're not getting emotional about my story, by the way. That's right. I noticed that a lot of my colleagues on the left, were not against the state, but more importantly, didn't take democracy seriously. I always felt that, if you were a genuine Democrat, it doesn't matter what you were, you had to be prepared to lose elections. Even if you're in a trade union and you wanted to go on strike, if you lost the vote, that was the genuine vote. And at the end of the day, democracy and freedom were non-negotiable. And I find that was the one thing that people, in my leftist circles couldn't really handle, which is why I ended up in the direction that I move in.
And if you ask... We're at an IPA MRC function right now, yeah.
Amongst some horrible people, who knows?
Nick?
I wonder, just an interesting thought, this. I mean, because we all thought we kind of won, didn't we, when the Berlin Wall came down. But there's a school of thought that says we didn't really, that if you look at the trajectory of the state in the West, of course it's been ever, ever growing, ever expanding, really since 1945 onwards. So the size and the power, the influence of the state in Australia, America, Britain, just about any Western country, is now considerably larger than it was, when Hayek was writing... Writing in the 1940s, or when indeed our own Robert Menzies, if I can put in a plug for this tremendous brand, the Menzies brand, was writing the Forgotten People speech with very, very dire warnings of what would happen if the state became too big and influential. You've got to say that sort of dystopian vision of Menzies has, I don't want to exaggerate it, but to some extent come to pass. And the role of the state now, and the role of other quasi-state-like bodies, like various commissions we've got, certainly the judiciary, it has much more influence on our everyday, on our personal lives now than it ever did. In a sense, we won the battle over denationalising the economy, but we somehow managed to nationalise the business of everyday life, haven't we?
Time for questions, Bill.
Frank, it's on. Yeah, good. Apart from criticising John for making you sit on those appalling stools,
we believe in freedom, and everyone should be able to see.
I just read your one of the articles on your website recently about the lack of engagement from ordinary people in Western democracies and in the political process, and the rise of populist parties across Europe. And you introduced the notion of solidarity, I think, to describe the reaction of what we might call ordinary people to the ruling classes and the political process. And I wonder if you mind just elaborating on that a bit, because it seems to me that the freedom of speech issue is, in a sense, underpinning it. People don't feel, ordinary people don't feel, they can say what they think because there's so many laws and restrictions on their right to speak.
Yeah, I mean, I think you hit the nail on the head. I was in Poland this April, and I gave a little spiel on freedom. But I also talked about the freedom to bring up your child the way you want to, freedom to express yourself and talk the way you want to. And when I finished, a bunch of these people came up to me and said, you know, Frank, you're the first person that said what we think. And then I said, well, I don't understand. You don't live in a Stalinist society anymore. Why don't you say those things that you think? And I kind of realized that when you go around Europe, there are millions and millions of people around whose views contradict, you know, the established opinion, but they are almost powerless to speak for themselves. And they find it very difficult to trust their own instinct because, you know, when everybody tells them that what they think is wrong, when everybody pathologizes their beliefs, even a confident person can feel insecure. And I think one of our jobs is to allow those people to give a voice, which is why I'm one of the few people who's got a university education who actually likes a lot of the populists. Not all of them, but a lot of what they do is a healthy, positive development because it's a step in their journey to give a voice to their expression. I think they're really important, and they have the capacity also of touching young people, which is very nice. When young kids, you know, begin to also, you know, sort of get drawn towards that, that too is a positive development. Sort of.
Nick?
I think, to some extent, we can turn ourselves into victims over this and say, look, we can't say what we think, we feel oppressed. Well, actually, we can say what we think. I don't do Twitter, but Frank does. And I asked him once why he did it, because it always seemed to be a bit of a waste of time. He said, I think you said, Frank, you like going on saying, am I the only one who thinks that? And then you get loads of replies back, people agreeing. So I think we do have more freedom to speak up if we're bold, if we don't allow them to push us back. Because I think one thing we've got to say, I mean, we do have to be upfront about this, that the sort of oppression of freedom of speech that Frank's parents and Frank experienced in Hungary, of course, is of a different order, a different quality. I mean, you're very unlikely to be put into jail for saying things. We can still say them. It's just that there's tremendous social and a moral pressure brought to bear on us. But it's up to us whether we accept that or not.
Frank, you mentioned you'd been in Poland, and this is a question to both of you. On the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall, how has the world changed, or has it not really? And as Nick said, has it simply been the fact that we celebrated freedom for 5 minutes and the state just continues to grow and grow and grow?
I think what has happened is that the fall of the Berlin Wall and the disintegration of all those regimes has in one sense clarified the battlefield. And I think that it's a battlefield that we're often too scared to talk about. We talk about not using the word, but actually we are in the middle of a culture war, right? And people don't like to use the word culture war. You know, often when I say it, people say you're exaggerating and how can you say it? But we are in the middle of a culture war where, you know, different cultural ideals that are fundamental to human, you know, dignity and human experience are being threatened by forces that, for lack of a better word, you can almost call evil or bad. And I think that's what has happened since that experience. The wars are less ideological, they're less political, but they're there all the time. I mean, you know, when I travel in Europe, I have a lot of, I'm not Christian myself, I'm not religious. A lot of Christian people come up to me and they say, I feel really uncomfortable wearing a cross, or I feel really uncomfortable about expressing my Christian beliefs at work. And the fact that they feel this way in Europe, you know, sort of indicates that something is terribly wrong. And Nick is obviously right. If you put the cross on and if you, you know, declare who you are, you're not going to go to a concentration camp. And in fact, you're likely to make an impact. But people feel intimidated. And I think this kind of cultural conflict that exists is one that really inhibits people's capacity to speak. And I think that's, to me, the big difference that has occurred since 25 years ago already. I'm getting old, yeah.
I always like to try and be optimistic about this. And look, one reason I think to be optimistic, when you think about it, is the digital era which has dawned since the fall of communism. And this is tremendously empowering. I mean, it's a funny old thing, isn't it, the internet and social media. It's developed in all sorts of ways that are quite unpleasant, and in some ways can you know, people attempt to use it very much to suppress free speech, to run campaigns against people, to intimidate people into not speaking out. I mean, you think of, I think particularly of the campaign against Alan Jones on 2GB in Sydney, and you know, when he supposedly said something a bit off colour at a private dinner about the Prime Minister, and this became, you know, the moral crusade of the week. Even Alan Jones was quite beaten back by the weight of internet warfare that was coming at him. But it was all from the internet, incidentally, because when they stopped carrying advertisements on the online, on the internet version of 2GB, the intimidation of Alan Jones's advertisers stopped. So it was all coming, I'm told, from Melbourne. In amongst all that, it is always, there is a platform now which we can express our views, and if they're good enough and strong enough, you can start building a community of people who sort of share those views and amplify them. And one of the things, one of the examples of this, I think, is the issue of climate science, where a view, you know, a whole discourse, a whole dialogue has happened largely on the internet, which is completely challenges the official dogma on this, which you know, in the restricted environments of the universities, and has been tremendously successful. Sites run on by amateurs or quasi amateurs, you know, people like What's Up With That and Joe Nova's site in WA, these have become sort of lightning rods and have allowed, you know, there's lots, not everything that's on there is sensible. A lot of it's wrong, but it'll be challenged. And so it is a new forum for debate where ideas can be put up and challenged. So I think that that's a good thing. And, you know, I don't know, it'd be interesting to ponder what would have happened if they'd had the internet during the height of the Cold War. But you would imagine it, things might have ended more quickly than they did.
I remember probably hearing the expression politically correct, probably sometime in the mid-70s. And it was a joke. And I think that what has happened, I suspect, is that we accepted it as a joke, but it's taken over. And we've, by default, find ourselves really accepting a position that we really wouldn't have ever accepted if we'd thought about it. But it's really crept up on us in a very insidious way. And I wonder if... it's a bit like the sustainability concept, it's one of those things that sounds all right for a start, but all of a sudden it takes over and you find that that idea is under control by people, that it really, you'd rather it wasn't. I wonder if you'd like to comment on that.
Well, it's a very good point, because what you call political correctness was made possible by the fact that people, you know, just ignored it, pretend it didn't really exist. But I find that very often all these words like sustainability, or like the emperor no clothes, you know, drama, where you come along and ask, you know, the obvious, you know, you find that people retreat. I was doing a radio program, and the guy who was the moderator turned around and asked us about sustainability, and by that time I was up to here with sustainability. I mean, you just cannot go anywhere in England without hearing about sustainable, you know, sort of communities, sustainable schools, sustainable toilets.
Frank, it's in the national curriculum in Australia.
Well, in England as well. Anyways, so I just said, I like to put in a good word for unsustainability. And the guy just looked at me and I said, look, human history shows that anything that's sustainable is not worth having, right? Because the whole of human progress has been to overcome the obstacles and the barriers of that generation. And it's precisely societies that have tried to be sustainable that have stagnated and stayed the same and have never really moved on. And I was expecting when I said that to get, you know, lynched or whatever. And everybody just, you know, at first they looked at me as if the guy didn't say this, did he? You know, nobody could possibly say this. And then, you know, just a few grumbles and everything else, because at the end of the day, these words that are part of our new vocabulary are intellectually empty. They're devoid of any real kind of meaning. And I think what we've got to do a lot more is make fun of it and just really rip it apart. I think I agree with Nick. You know, we have to be forward-looking, optimistic. Right? We have to remember one thing, which is that throughout human history, freedom has always been under threat. So it's not a new thing. you know, you will never have a day ever in human existence when freedom is arrived and is final. We can just sit back. It will always have to be fought for. And I think today, a lot of that is taking up those kinds of concepts, which are more or less unchallenged. I mean, go out on the streets and take the piss out of sustainability. Don't just kind of allow them to monopolize our language. I mean, it's a completely irrational concept. And yet we kind of are embarrassed, we kind of look away and allow this language to circulate and as you say, dominate our children. I mean, I, as a father, one of the first things I did was to brief my son about sustainability. And his whole class, he said, that's what they say, Furedi's thing, that sustainability is nonsense. And that's what we got to do. We got to get our children, you know, to understand that this is, these are nonsense words. Just like we did in Silence Hungary, that this doesn't make any sense at all. And I think if we do that, then the confident external aspect of it will crumble away.
I just had a wonderful year in my spare time editing this book of Christopher Pearson's writing. There were about 880 articles in the end, and we went back, I think, as far as 1994. But, you know, the thing about Christopher was he always would fight the fashionable argument. The breaking point for him was when he was a Maoist in his young days at university, but he remembered going to the university club to celebrate the news that Pol Pot had taken Phnom Penh for the Khmer Rouge, and they drank Great Western Champagne. And Christopher said he always looked back on that with shame ever since, and that he decided he'd never take the fashionable idea seriously again, would always challenge it. And this book is full of examples of how he challenged that, and in almost every case has been proved right. But I just remember he wrote this just shortly before he died. It probably understates the case, he wrote, that I have no truck with PC and there's not an equal opportunity bone in my body.
And that book, of course, is available for purchase after this evening.
Tony Thomas is my name.
Hello, Tony.
A little parable about freedom. A week ago, I was at my Rotary Club and there was a nice middle-aged, nicely dressed lady on our table. And I said, what's your job? And she said, oh, I'm a police superintendent. And I said, as a joke, okay, where's your gun? And she said, quite seriously, we have been told by Commissioner Ken Lay, that we should not wear our uniforms except on official necessary business, and this Rotary meeting is not necessary business. So I concluded from that our police force is now frightened to wear its uniform. Could you comment on that?
Well, I got an even worse story, which is that, I'm not a militarist. I mean, I think armies are fine, but I was truly horrified when I discovered that in England, sort of soldiers who wear their the army is actually discouraging soldiers from wearing their uniforms in case they get beaten up or in case they get harassed. And I kind of think, well, look, these are the guys that are meant to be fighting for our country. They're putting their lives on the line. And yet when they come back home, they feel insecure. I mean, why go to Afghanistan or Iraq or anywhere else if when you come back home, you're kind of treated as a second-class citizen? And I do think that when you come to this extreme position, we do have a problem, you know, sort of in terms of taking ourselves seriously. We have wounded soldiers coming, who came back from Afghanistan and from Iraq, going into hospitals in Birmingham and feeling insecure because some of the Muslim doctors and nurses were giving them a hard time, telling them, this is really bad what you've done. Imagine, you know, you got your legs sawed off, you're lying back there, and you don't even feel safe and secure in a hospital back home. I think these kinds of incidents are an indication of that kind of cowardice we were discussing earlier on, where even the basic infrastructure of society, and nobody talks about this. I mean, that's the other thing. People are embarrassed to talk about this. If I was a soldier or a soldier's partner, I would just, I would not shut up about this, and yet, these are the dirty little secrets that we kind of keep under the carpet, rather than bring to the surface because it's so embarrassing. Nick?
One of the great Australian characteristics that I celebrate in my book is this sort of, we couldn't care less sort of, live and let live attitude, which is really represented by me, for me, by Paul Hogan in Crocodile Dundee. You know, he goes to America and they love him because he just doesn't give a stuff about formality or rules. He just is genuine and whatever. And look, having said I want to be optimistic, I do feel that the example you've drawn is that process being reversed. That it would have been a point where people would have said, "Oh, come off it," you know. I mean, that sort of pomposity, that sort of rules for rules' sake, would never have had any place, I don't think, in the Australia that I used to imagine, at any rate, or possibly the Australia as it still is in most of the country. But we have to resist it because I think in doing that we're offering the world a great service. I mean, I think the Australian larrikin is a character that is exportable because everybody loves common sense.
So we've got time for three questions there, and then Alan. Yep, so just here.
Thank you. On you. I'd just like to ask the team what they think the Prime Minister means by the term Team Australia. And does it include any of the values that he has been known to support in the past?
Do you want to ask an easy question? Nick, do you want to go first?
Yeah, Frank might have, I don't know if you follow this argument, but he used the term Team Australia to describe sort of the body, I don't know, the civic, the populace, I suppose. And it seemed completely uncontroversial to me, but it became a matter of enormous controversy. Look, it's not a particularly elegant phrase, but look, I know what he means. It is those of us who feel we are citizens of Australia, feel some loyalty towards this country, its values, and particularly loyalty towards our fellow citizens, and feel everybody deserves equal respect, all those wonderful Australian things. It's not hard, you know, and that's why I think that we need to be much firmer in asserting what it means to be Australian and what the responsibilities of a citizen are, because at the end of the day they're not really hard. You know, you don't really have to know who Farlap is, you just have to be able to behave in a civil manner and take your, and make your contribution to this country.
Yeah, I mean, I take the view there's no point fighting the war in Iraq or bombing Syria or doing this and that unless you're prepared to stand up for what you are at home. I think the key battles are to be fought are not in Iraq or in Syria. The key battles are to be fought in Australia, in Europe, England, places like that, where you have to define what is your way of life, you know, what is the bottom line that we are really all about, you know, what do we expect of each other, what are our responsibilities and commitments, and that's got to be spelled out and discussed and debated. It's not something that you just force down people's throat, it's something you have a grown-up discussion about, and I think, I don't know about Australia, but certainly in Europe, we are very scared or inhibited about having that grown-up debate, but until we have that, nothing's going to happen that's of any positive consequence over there, because the real battle is for the hearts and minds in our own societies. And that's, unfortunately, what's often being evaded and ignored.
Yeah, thanks. Along those lines, I wonder if you can help me with, it seems a paradox to me about moral reasoning. Since the 60s and 70s, people are very reluctant to make or listen to arguments that use moral reasoning, that talk about right and wrong. So then we had moral relativism, moral equivalence. But in the last 10 years, it seems we have this big wave of moralising. This conspicuous offence, conspicuous outrage. And so if people don't express themselves in the right way or behave, you know, they have a faux pas in public, there's this wave of outrage that something must be done about that. And it seems to me these things are linked, but I don't quite understand how they're linked.
Yeah, as it happens, my next book is about that. it's something I've been struggling with because, as you say, it is horrible when you have a world where moral language has been marginalised. where we find it very difficult to talk about right and wrong. I mean, politicians very seldom use the word good and evil, right and wrong. They just kind of, even religious people, I know a lot of people who are in, you know, like Christian priests, where I live, and you talk to our local priest, instead of saying, I'm the leader because of my theological knowledge, he's very, you know, proud of the fact that he's got a degree as a counselor. And I say, well, actually, if your reputation depends on therapeutics rather than on religion, you're devaluing your own authority. You know, it's not about morality anymore; it's about health. You know, sort of. And I think that what has happened is, for a variety of reasons, you know, sort of, this is part of the whole cultural conflict that I was discussing earlier on. We've become very, very, very scared to talk about moral language. That's been, you know, every time you use the word moral, people put a scare quotes around that. But of course, at the end of the day, we all need to have meaning in life. I mean, all of us, no matter what side of the fence we're sitting on, we have a drive to want to know what is right and what is wrong. But in a world where morality is not allowed to flourish and where we suffer moral literacy, what we end up doing is what you're describing is not moral discussion, but moralizing. And moralizing is very different. Mm-hmm. Moralizing means attaching so-called moral language to non-moral questions. So, for example, environmentalists talk about McDonald's as evil food. You know, sort of, they talk about green sins. I mean, I don't know if you did that in Australia, but they talk about green sins when you don't recycle or whatever. And if you look at the words that the language that has occurred, we kind of, you know, most moral language has become attached to health things, you know, obesity. You know, sort of, I mean, all these kind of medical problems are intertwined with moral ones, and that's how we try to kind of express ourselves. And therefore, I think what has happened is we do moralize more than ever before, but we still don't have a grown-up discussion about what is right and what is wrong. How many times, you know, do we find a public figure saying this is really evil, and then explaining why that is evil, or this is really, really good? No, instead what they say, research shows. Evidence says, you know, that's what they hide behind. I think this is one of the big issues of our time, because unless we kind of regain a moral vocabulary, then what do you socialize young people into? You know, what are the values? And it's precisely because of the absence of morality that, or moral thinking and moral thought, that the discussions about who we are as a society are evaded. Because if you're not sure about our own values, or scared to talk about values, then of course, you know, you're going to change the subject and talk about recycling. You know.
And Frank, I could... I could add to that with an example that everyone in this room would be familiar with, but you might not be, which of course is our former Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, who said climate change is the great moral challenge of our time. And of course, what we're familiar with is that as soon as he said that, if you disagreed with him, you were immoral. He disqualified you from having a different opinion.
Yeah, that's exactly what's happening. And I suppose, yeah, I like that term, moralizing, and that's what happens. You know, what we sort of had to, we came to a compact, didn't we, in the federal parliament. As Bob would know, it's okay to be a Catholic and to believe, for instance, that abortion is unconscionable, but you can't stand up and make that your public policy reason, you know, and rightly so. I mean, it would be if a majority of Catholics took over and decided that for their great moral reason they're going to ban abortion, well, that wouldn't be fair to those who are from a different faith. So we separate, you know, moral from empirical or political arguments. But that doesn't apply these days to the Greens, for instance, who moralise all the time. Those same rules don't apply. And it doesn't even apply to the left. I've got a piece in my column tomorrow about a guy called Bentley who wrote a column in, a former advisor to Rudd and Gillard, who wrote a column recently about the economy, saying, I think he's British, isn't he? He said, look, the word fairness has got much more potency than the advice of Treasury. And there you go. So you take a moral concept like fairness, and it trumps the empirical evidence in the policy debate. And that's a very dangerous thing. So I think we have to turn around and call them on this and say, okay, you know, we've agreed, haven't we, that moral arguments, You can just mean to say you can hold a moral position, you can state it, but the moral argument is not the trump card.
Final question up the back. Alan.
In terms of freedom of speech, both of you quite correctly point out that this is a really important aspect of life. And I think, Frank, you said it was non-negotiable, but you also said democracy was non-negotiable. And yet, sometimes these things are in conflict. For example, the American Republic wouldn't allow freedom of speech in the sense of communism to be preached because it saw that as a threat to its own republican value. The German Basic Law doesn't allow Nazism to be promoted in terms of freedom of speech because that would undermine the basic freedoms. I wonder whether there is some nuance in this freedom of speech that you want to inject into there, because in a sense it's a one hot shot. If you actually allow freedom of speech and then you do get Islamic jihadists or communists or whatever else, it's very difficult to overthrow it. In fact, maybe it's impossible to overthrow it. So do you not see, or do you see, any case for constraints on freedom of speech in the light of that freedom of speech may actually undermine the basic republican liberty values that we have?
Well, I know I'm going to be in a minority on one on this, but I take an absolutist position on freedom of speech. I think the German Basic Law is fundamentally anti-democratic and wrong, and I'm against censoring, the radical jihadists for the same reason. And the reason for that is not because I'm this incorrigible, open-minded liberal, I want to expose myself to these horrible ideas, but it seems to me that speech acts, that's what we're talking about, ideas are going to challenge our way of life, who we are all the time, no matter what. If we resort to administrative or bureaucratic devices to shut it out, we're not going to solve the problem. All that we're going to do is to signal the fact that we're too scared or that we don't believe in ourselves sufficiently to argue. So what worries me about, for example, some of these radical jihadist ideas is not that they are allowed to flourish openly, because I think that's perfectly all right. What I'm really worried about is that nobody argues against them. So that, they're flourishing. I'm one of the few academics in the university system that actually debates some of these people. I've gone up and argued because I felt that it was important that the audience, there's a counter-argument to what they're saying. A lot of people on campus say, we must ban them, we shouldn't allow them to be here. But when they're there and they're speaking and they're influencing people, they go home and, have a glass of wine or something. They don't actually do anything to kind of argue against it. And it seems to me that administrative solutions actually spare us of the responsibility of putting the case for freedom and arguing for that. And therefore, it's a lazy way out, but it's also a very ineffective way out. And it seems to me that what it does is it means that true Democrats, genuine Democrats, actually occupy the moral low ground instead of the high ground. And it seems to me that without freedom of speech, right, as being a completely enshrined, sacred kind of concept, then we lose the moral authority to fight the enemies of democracy. I think that's why freedom of speech doesn't mean that you allow people to threaten you. It doesn't mean, for example, it doesn't mean that you allow people to, sort of come to your house and force you out of your house. It doesn't mean that you're against the things that are to do with kind of anti-democratic acts. It basically means that it's ideas that, no matter how dangerous that they are, that you're prepared to challenge. And as Mill said, even the worst ideas, sort of force you to clarify your own. Even dealing with the worst, even the lies, means that, that this is something that you take seriously. And if you're going to curb the freedom of speech, what you're really saying is that, we're too scared that those other people are going to be influenced by it. We're really worried that those people are either too stupid or alternatively, we haven't got the arguments to kind of fight against it. Just one final point. I was in Holland a year ago, and I was debating some people who wanted to censor this guy Wilders, who runs a kind of fairly right-wing, semi-racist party. And, I said, you can't do that. You know, he's kind of putting these arguments forward. And this woman gets up and says to me, "But you know, Frank, he's so eloquent. He's such a great speaker. You know, we've got to stop him speaking." And I thought that really kind of brought it out. And I said, "Well, actually, that's a good argument for you to, you know, learn how to speak yourself. You know, it's a good argument for you to develop your rhetorical skills so you can argue against it." And the idea that somehow you kind of solve the problem of demagogy by administration, I think it's always been a fatal mistake, and it's always better to bring it out in the open, but then we have to have the courage to kind of fight it. So that's the challenge for us today, not to worry about, you know, banning radical jihadists, but to actually bring them out in the open and confront them and have a real argument, which we're not having at the moment.
Frank, we're about to... We're about to hear from an elected politician, and we're very excited about that. Just before we hear from Senator Bob Day, can I just ask you one final question about where do we go next? So we've spoken about freedom of speech in the UK. We had the phenomenon that frankly scared me, whereby the David Cameron government considered licensing of the press or some form of licensing. We had that debate here in Australia under the Gillard government. Unfortunately, we've had the Abbott government backing off its promise to change Section 18C. As a firm believer in democracy, what is our role? How do we talk to our elected representatives about the importance of these issues?
Well, I think that I'm sure you know the answer yourself, because presumably what you're doing is in part trying to do that. I think there's one even more important thing that needs to be done, far more important than talking to elected representatives. No insult intended, which is that we got to wage a campaign with young people. I think young people do not get exposed to the kind of ideas that we're discussing here. They remain in a different world, and the younger you are, the more likely you're going to say, "Oh man, free speech, oh, chill out, you know, sort of, oh, what's the big deal, you know, free speech." The more likely they're going to have that kind of attitude. It's not their fault. It's because of the world that we kind of brought them into. I think we need to take young people far more seriously. They are very idealistic when they're 15, 16, 17, before they've been ruined, you know, by the established institutions. And I think it's just quite important to get out there and find a way of connecting with them, kind of drawing them out, finding different kinds of material that appeals to them, and really trying to get as many young people involved as possible. Because unless we get, you know, a sizable group of young kids who are lovers of liberty, then we've got a problem. Right, I think we've got a really big problem. I think that's the key thing.